questions from the scripture that were asked during Jesus in Gethsemane, the plot to kill him, his death, his burial, and his resurrection. We will begin with Jesus in Gethsemane.
Then he returned to the disciples and found them sleeping. "Could you men not watch with me for 1 hour?" he asked Peter. "Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." Matthew 26:40-41.
And Pilate questions the crowd.
"Which of the two do you want me to release to you?" Matthew 27:21.
Barabbas!
"What shall I do with Jesus who is called the Christ?" asked Pilate. Matthew 27:22.
"Crucify him! Crucify him!"
"Why, what evil has he done?" asked Pilate. But they shouted all the louder,
"Crucify him!"
Jesus on the cross.
About the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Matthew 27:46.
And the women at the tomb.
In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead?" Luke 24:5. "He is not here. He has risen."
Celebrate. He's risen.
Amen.
We've come together today to celebrate. This is a high note in Christendom, that the Savior lives forevermore. And because He lives, because He rose again, that's part of our eternal hope in Christ Jesus. Guys, you look really, really great today. And we welcome you to this service, our Easter celebration. And we've got a couple more things that we'll be doing, but welcome. We've got a couple of, our first time guest, we've got a token of appreciation for you coming with us. Please take time to fill this out and tear this off at the bottom. Now, just letting you know, one of you might get a little reward for dropping it into play or putting it outside. Okay? So I'm enticing you to fill out the little piece of paper. Okay? We just want to give you a shout out and thank you for coming in a text message or something. But please take time to do that. At this time, I'm going to ask the ushers to come and we'll take up our tithe and our offering at this time. If you're visiting with us, we do not require, we do not even expect you to give and to sow in this ministry. If you feel like you want to, that's fine. This is really for our group here, the family. But we appreciate you being here and just listen to Ms. Joyce as we give and as we worship. This morning, Last time I read around 6:30 this morning, and 138 people their life was taken. What was attacked was upscale hotels as well as several churches. So we need to pray for that city in mourning. And is any other need or request that would be notified by uplifted hands? Okay, let's pray with Judas. This is not the one who betrayed Christ, but I'm going to ask Johnny to lead us in prayer. Let's pray together, guys. Let's lift these requests up.
Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day, Lord, that we can gather together. Thank you, Lord, for this season, Lord, that we celebrate by two resurrections. Thank you, Lord, that you came to save us, Lord, that you died on the cross. We also thank you, Lord, that you were resurrected. This is sitting at the right hand of the Father, Lord, make a intercession for us. You said, Lord, if I go, I'll prepare a place for you. We just thank you for that opportunity that we can, if we make the right choices, Lord, that we can spend eternity in heaven with you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that the invitation, Lord, is still for today, Lord, to come. We ask you, Lord, for the day, Lord, for the week, the hour, and the actual Lord, to surround the Lord and welcome the bombs that went off there. We just ask you, Lord, to be with those people. Lord, we just ask you, Lord, to cover them, Lord, help them, Lord, put their trust in you. We ask you, Lord, to bless this day, Lord, those that are sick and blind. We ask you, Lord, to touch them, Lord, and send by you to pray for you. Lord, thank you, Lord, for that day. We ask you, Lord, for the pastor who walks today as he brings the bread of life. We ask you, Lord, to anoint him. We ask you, Lord, give him the words. Give us ears to hear, hearts to receive, Lord, what you say this morning. In Jesus' name.
I invite you to stand this morning as we open up that Jesus paid it all. I want you to know Jesus didn't pay 50%. Jesus paid 100%. Hallelujah. Jesus paid 100%.
seated. We got to move a couple of mics, and we'll have the disciples and Jesus coming up in just a moment.
We are healed by your sacrifice.
Thank you, guys. Let's give the kids and these guys another hand clap. Give a quick shout out to the ones who participated, the one who prepped everything, the practicing with the listen. What was that?
Life,
right? So if a crying baby kind of like gets on your nerves a little bit, you know, maybe you don't think it's a place for a baby being a sanctuary, talk with the pastor. It's because of him that they're in here, because we want to, it's not very often that we bring the whole family in together, and we want to celebrate the resurrection and celebrate life today. So hopefully, I don't know if there's still some outside or not, directing traffic or giving out some, a little bit of Easter candy, but you guys look beautiful to me, and if your baby gets a little restless, we've got the nursery workers that are normally serving in the nursery. Some of them are stationed out here. They'll help direct you. But you can blame me if I get a little uncomfortable with that. So just a quick shout out. Thanks for all that helped with getting the kids together. I thought it was beautiful and reciting part of scripture. And the guys getting together with that song. And yesterday, I know not everyone was here yesterday, but we had an Easter egg hunt and what was called an Extreme Agent Challenge. And it was just a wonderful day, beautiful day that God, see if it was on Friday, we'd had to cancel out because of the storms, but just so beautiful. Now I've got to, Bree, I don't know how many mistakes I make daily, but I made one big one yesterday. A guy named Jordan Bravel asked me, he said, "Hey, you want some sunscreen?" And I said, "No, I'm good." And that was one of my mistakes. I got a little bit too much sun yesterday, but it's all good. But thank you for being here. Did anybody get a red grapefruit chapstick this morning? A red grapefruit, a pink? I'm just curious. I just saw it and I threw it in a box and I'm just checking. Again, thank you for being here. If you're a first-time guest, please make sure you fill out that card for us. But let's get started, guys. Thank you again for being here. Just a great day, and we celebrate. That song that was the guys did that short skit with, the name of that song is "By His Wounds." And that actually comes almost verbatim from a scripture that Isaiah prophesied in Isaiah chapter 53. This is how the verse goes. It says, "But he was pierced for our transgressions," or our rebellion. "He was crushed for our iniquities." Another word for iniquities is sin. "And the punishment that was brought," or that brought us peace, "was on him. And by his wounds we are healed." Isaiah 53:5. Now, Isaiah was born in the 8th century B.C. He died in the 7th century B.C., which that puts that about 700 years before Christ was even born. So he prophesied that all this stuff would take place. And this is just one prophecy, just one that song was about, of several hundred that foreshadowed or pointed to the coming of Christ and what he would go through. But we celebrate the history, and we celebrate the significance of what this day is, Resurrection Sunday. Now, I'm going to tell you, and I told the group yesterday, I love jelly beans. I love jelly beans. And I don't know if they made them just for Easter or not. I don't know. But today, it's not about jelly beans. And it's not about the Easter bunny. It's about Jesus Christ. And we praise God. He is risen. And one translation says, "He is risen indeed." So we rejoice in that. Let's go to the Word this morning. And I'd like to read out of Luke chapter 24. All of the Gospels have the rendition or a retelling of the author's thoughts and their point of view. But go to Luke today. This is actually the last chapter that's written in St. Luke. I just want to read, actually I'll read several verses today. I hear the pages turning. I love that sound. I don't know if everybody can handle it or not, but I love the sound. Glory to God. Luke 24, begin with verse chapter 1. But very early, on Sunday morning, the women went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared. They found that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance. So they went in, but they didn't find the body of the Lord Jesus. They stood there puzzled. Two men suddenly appeared to them, clothed in dazzling robes. And these men that are referenced here, I actually later on will find out they really weren't men, but they were angels. Let's read on verse 5. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground. Then the men asked, "Why are you looking among the dead for someone who is alive? He isn't here. He has risen from the dead. Remember what he told you back in Galilee." So again, we echo this, we herald and we yell, we proclaim the same message. He is risen. And he is risen indeed. This victorious story for all of us to enjoy. It's recorded, as I said, in all of the Gospels. We could pick several scriptures to read this morning. But I just want us to realize as we read this, I want us to take a step back. The people that we read about didn't have the privilege that we have. We've got the privilege of the history of 2,000 years and the development of the story. We've got the privilege of having the whole New Testament, not just the Gospels. They wrote the Gospels later on. But as we, it's easy for us to get lost and almost say, "I can't believe they didn't see it. It was prophesied. They knew, some of them knew Scripture very, very well. But didn't they know? If we put ourselves where they were at, it would have been the same way. The stories would have been told the same exact way. But as we read, I'm going to read on a little bit later in the same passage. But the followers, the disciples of Christ, they had a plethora of emotions that were going on. They were disappointed. They obviously grieving and mourning of their leader, their teacher, their rabbi. Being hung on the cross, anxious. Some of them were confused. I'm sure that the week and the undertaking of the week, they were very tired, bewilderment. We have scripture that says some doubted, and certainly disappointed, heartbroken. There's a long list, and certainly that's not exhaustive what I just went through. But Christ, I want to read where Christ showed himself to a couple of his disciples today. And again, I could have picked several things, but these interactions, the one that I, there's several interactions, but the one that I'm going to read, it helps us provide us with the foundation of our eternal hope in this story. And it verifies that because of this victory, because of his victory, we also will have victory. With this life in Christ. This authenticity of the story that Christ rose again, that he was resurrected on the third day, not just prophesied, but it happened. And just so many things we could have read, so I wanted to reference, there's a long list that we can make to help verify that we know this is true. It's hard for us to maybe connect with something that happened years and years ago, but as Luke, we're reading the first book that Luke wrote, which read that Luke 24. But the second book that we have recorded that Luke wrote was Acts. In Acts chapter 1, this is where he said, he says, after his suffering, after he is meaning Christ, after Christ's suffering, he presented himself to them and gave them many convincing proofs that he was alive. And they appeared to them over, or he appeared to them over a period of 40 days, and he spoke about the kingdom. He came back. He talked with them. He ate with them. He spent time with them. He interacted with them. Some of them one-on-one. Some of them as a group. It's just a beautiful story. So I want to read part of the story. If we stay in Luke chapter 24, but I want to begin with verse 13. Remember all the emotions that were going through their minds. As this story will depict, they were in Jerusalem, and they were heading back to where they were from. And the town that they were from was 7 miles away from Jerusalem, and it was a small town called Emmaus. Luke 24:13. That same day, two of Jesus' followers were walking to the village of Emmaus, 7 miles from Jerusalem. And as they walked along, they were talking about everything of what had happened. As they talked and discussed these things, Jesus himself suddenly came and began walking with them. Verse 16, but Jesus kept with them from God, excuse me, God kept them from recognizing them. He asked them, what are you discussing so intently as you walk along? They stopped short, sadness written across their face, and one of them, Cleopas, replied, you must be the hungry one in Jerusalem who hasn't heard of all the things that has happened for the last few days. What things, Jesus asked. The things that happened to Jesus, the man of Nazareth, he said. He was a prophet who did powerful miracles. He was a mighty teacher in the eyes of God and all the people. But our leading priests and other religious leaders handed him over to be condemned to death, and they crucified him. And he had hoped he was the Messiah. We had hoped he was the Messiah who had come to rescue Israel. This all happened 3 days ago. Then some of the women, listen to this now, some of the women from our group, some of the women from our group of his followers were at the tomb early this morning. They came back with an amazing report. They said that his body was missing. And they said they had seen angels and told him that Jesus was alive. Verse 24, some of the men ran out to see, and sure enough, the body was gone, just as the women had said. Then Jesus said to them, you foolish people, you find it so hard to believe all the prophets wrote in Scripture. Wasn't it clearly depicted that the Messiah would have to suffer all the things before he entered into glory? Then Jesus took them through the writings of Moses and all the prophets, explaining all the Scriptures, the things concerning him. And by this time, they were near Emmaus. And at the end of their journey, Jesus acted as if he were going on. But they begged him, stay the night with us, since it is getting late. So he went home with them. Verse 30, so as they sat down to eat, he took the bread and blessed it. And then he broke it and he gave it to them. Suddenly their eyes were opened and they recognized him. And at that moment, he disappeared. They said to each other, didn't our hearts burn within us as he talked with us on the road and explained the Scriptures to us? And within the hour, they were on their way back to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 disciples and the others who gathered with them, who said, the Lord is risen. He's appeared to Peter. Later on, in the same reading, Christ is with the disciples. And he says, peace be with you. John wrote, and again, it's the same setting. Christ he's risen, and now he's interacting with the different disciples, more than just the 11, but he's interacting with them, and he's trying to give them peace. And this same Jesus, he desires to do the same thing for us. Often we hear words like if you read out of John, we hear him at a funeral. But it's alive today. God, through his son Jesus, wants to deliver peace to the followers of his son Jesus. John wrote the words of Christ. If you had to write a red letter edition, it's the word is written in red. It says, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. Not as the world give do I give to you. Do not let your hearts be troubled. And let it not be fearful." They said, and I actually believe it's Cleopas and his wife, Mary. It speaks in another gospel about, she was one of them at the cross. So that's who the two, I believe it is. But it says, "Didn't our hearts burn within us?" And it's not a heart burn like we're taking, you know, a Zantac or a Tums or something like that. It's the emotion of being the draw of your spirit to connect with God. But many things that the disciples and the followers of Christ, all the emotions, the grief, the sadness, the disbelief, the disappointment that he didn't show himself to be king as they thought he was going to show himself to be king. And certainly, I've mentioned it some doubt. But what I read in this is that we serve a mighty and a big God. That he cares not just for his disciples, but that's what we're reading about. That he cares for his disciples so much. And he was trying to tell them, "Hey, I'm leaving. I'm going to come back later on. But as I leave, I'm going to leave the Comforter. God's going to send the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, to be with you." But what captures my mind here is how Christ took his time to interact with his followers. And he desires to do the same thing. He desires for you to connect in a real, in a strong, in a vibrant way with his son, Jesus Christ, through the Holy Spirit. There's many things, many stories I could read, but I chose to read about the road to Emmaus. I could have read about Mary. And when she had gone to the tomb, and she's talking to Jesus, and she thinks he's the gardener. He says, what have you done with him? But what he says is, "Mary." And then she says, "Rabboni," or "teacher." But just as Christ called Mary's name, he knows each one of our names, each one of our names. He don't have to look your number up. Oh, I can't remember what that number is in the phone. He knows us by name. And he calls us today. He desires a close, intimate walk with each one of you. And I don't care where we're at spiritually. He desires for it to be closer. If you feel like you're a long, long ways away from the Lord, he wants it to be closer. And if you think you're super slink this morning, he still wants you to be closer to him. I could have read the story about Thomas and the interaction there. We know, most of us know that story. Christ showed up to many of the apostles, and Thomas wasn't there. And he said, "Unless I see, unless I touch, I'm not going to believe that mess." See, some doubted that he rose again. But he showed himself to Thomas to assure Thomas that this was real. It wasn't a falsehood. It wasn't a lie. The body wasn't stolen and hidden. He was alive. And he wanted to assure. And Thomas goes on from that point when Christ said, "You're going to believe because you see and you feel?" He says, "Blessed or happy are those who believe yet have not seen." But he still goes, get the picture, and he still goes to Thomas to assure him of the good news and who he is. And Thomas, unfortunately, that's what we call him, Doubting Thomas. But Thomas goes on from that point, that intimate relationship, that intimate conversation. He goes on and does mighty works for the kingdom of God as an apostle. I could have read where the interaction that the disciples had eaten with Christ one morning. And after finishing up, Christ says, Simon, or Peter, do you love me? Lord, you know I love you. And then the second time, he says, Simon, do you love me? Feed my sheep, tend my sheep. And then the third time, this time it kind of hit home. Simon, do you love me? And that third time, I think it actually hurt. Some of the translations read that Peter was hurt from this. And he says, Lord, you know everything. And as I pause and think about that, God does know everything. What a powerful statement it is. He knows right where we're at. He knows if we're following Him. He knows if we're not. He knows if we're sitting here in grief. He knows if we are toting around an offense that happened yesterday, or we're toting around an offense that happened 20 years ago that we should let go and forgive. God knows all those things. God knows that sometimes we're bewildered, and life just, it's been a curveball to us. And a curveball, sometimes, it's been a long time since I've seen a curveball, a long, long time. But sometimes if you're expecting, you know, a fastball or some other pitch, and that curveball comes, it catches us off guard. And sometimes in life, we get caught off guard. God knows if you're brokenhearted, and the things that we face from day to day, He knows. In closing, this is a different guy singing, but I want to play a song. And it's by His wounds we are healed. It's the same song that the guys did their short skit with. But this same Jesus who showed Himself to Cleopas, or I'll say that the two disciples walking the Emmaus Road, the same Christ that showed Himself to Mary, the same Christ that showed Himself to Thomas and to Peter and to many, many others, He wants to show Himself true and strong to you as well. Today's a beautiful day. I'm going to ask that if you connect with this and you need to hear, to feel, to touch this name, God named Jesus, I'm going to open up the altars and have a conversation with Him. He desires to communicate with you. I'm going to ask that you bow your heads as this song plays.
Thank you. sin. He was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our sin. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him.
Thank you.